Es geht los mit kein oder ein nachhaltiger Fisch, beziehungsweise how sustainable is MSC certified seafood really? Let's talk about finning and fins naturally attached and what the MSC does in this respect. Und mein Name ist Iris Ziegler von SHARKPROJECT International. Und ich leite bei SHARKPROJECT den Bereich International Cooperation. Das heißt, wir sind diejenigen, die zusammen mit ganz vielen anderen NGOs versuchen, auf politischer, auf Policy-Ebene Einfluss zu nehmen. Das gilt sowohl auf Regierungen als auch auf Vereinigungen, zum Beispiel auch auf RFMOs, also die regionalen Fischereimanagement-Organisationen, aber auch auf Organisationen wie zum Beispiel das MSC, das ja ein privates Label ist, was aber claimt oder behauptet, dass es nachhaltig den Fischfang fördert und garantiert und dadurch zum Erhalt der Biodiversität in unseren Meeren beiträgt und wie sie immer so schön sagen, Oceans teeming with life. Und International Cooperation, und das ist mein Slogan und den würde ich hier jetzt gerade einmal nennen wollen, ist Together we are stronger, weil wenn einer alleine etwas fordert, dann hört vielleicht jemand zu. Wenn aber alle das Gleiche fordern, dann müssen sie zuhören. And with this, I'd like to switch to English and welcome my guest tonight. And I'm really glad we could convince Alex to join us. Alex Hofford from Shark Guardian has kindly accepted the invitation to join us on this challenging webinar tonight, because it's going to be challenging for him in double aspects. I didn't really give him much time to prepare for it. And it's going to be German and English. And Alex, you told me your German is kind of, you can communicate, but not good enough for such a discussion.
Yeah, so, ich kann ein bisschen Deutsch sprechen, aber nicht so viel.
Okay, dann können wir ja auf Deutsch weitermachen, or maybe not. Alex, we're going to do it as it's easiest for you, but if there is any point you'd like to switch to German, please feel free to do so. I think the audience would definitely appreciate, but of course we go in English. Alex Hofford from Shark Guardian is a marine wildlife campaigner and a trustee of Shark Guardian, but he has a really interesting history because as you also see in the background, he's now living in the UK, but he's not always lived there. He's really lived abroad and for a long time, actually, in Hong Kong. And Alex, please, could you introduce yourself to our audience and just tell us a little bit what you've been doing and how you got to be so interested in marine wildlife and their conservation? And obviously, looking for today, why sharks are something you really care for.
Sure. Okay, thanks, Iris. Thank you very much for inviting me to this seminar. So my name's Alex Hofford. I'm with an NGO called Shark Guardian. And my as you say, my history goes on sharks goes back a number of years now. I found myself in Hong Kong in the late 90s. My background is in photojournalism, and I was living in an area of Hong Kong called Sheung Wan, which is the center of the, the dried seafood trade. So that includes not only sharks, but abalone and all kinds of marine creatures that are used in Chinese cuisine and traditional Chinese medicine. And so when I used to go out on my photojournalism assignments each day, I'd be passing by sacks and sacks of shark fin on the way to work, and I would just take a few pictures here and there, and before I knew it, I'd amassed this large photo library of pictures of all these dead sharks in Hong Kong. And I just was wondering what's really going on here. This seems incredible that this is going on and nobody really is talking about this very much. So I developed this thought and came up with an idea to have to write a book. So I have a book called Man and Shark, and we did a short movie and then a NGO grew out of the book, and I started to work, not only doing commercial photography, but editorial photography, and then focusing on conservation photography, environmental, but more with a interest in marine issues because of the shark fin background in Hong Kong. So I tracked the entire supply chain from the diving underwater, see the beauty of the sharks in places like Mozambique and in the Pacific, but then see the supply chain to the markets in Yemen, and all the way through the middle part is the opaque part, which is the trafficking. But when it gets to the market, documenting the markets in Hong Kong and the restaurants, and finally people eating it, and that's the entire supply chain of shark fin. And so I then began working with Wild Aid in about 2014, and I was running the campaigns in Hong Kong to get the airlines to stop shipping shark fin, starting with Cathay Pacific, which is the hardest one of all, based on the premise that it was very difficult for any airline or any shipper to be absolutely 100% clear about whether a fin is from a CITES listed, that means an endangered species that's not allowed to ship by law unless there's certain permits are given, but often they're not, or whether it's from a non-listed species, because they all look kind of grey and triangular. And then I was working on a campaign to get the restaurants in Hong Kong to stop selling shark fin, and we managed to get about 120 restaurants belonging to the Maxim's Group, which is the Hong Kong's third largest restaurants chain, to stop selling shark fin. And so, you know, just got quite famous locally in Hong Kong for that, and just getting up the Hong Kong shark fin traders' nostrils every week for several years. And then I found myself back in London, and I'm now working with Shark Guardian. So yeah, I can't hear you. You're on mute, Iris.
Sorry, thank you. And now you're here, and that's great. Yeah. Thanks a lot for joining us. I was just saying, but obviously you didn't hear me, you were probably not just famous, but notorious in Hong Kong, especially in those circles that are involved in the trade, and they probably weren't too happy you being there. That is for sure.
Well, yeah, I mean, these guys, there's not that many of them, and they're just, their bark is louder than their bites. Often there's documentaries where they're coming out and, you know, pretend to attack at somebody making a documentary, but actually they're quite timid, a lot of them.
Well, maybe on land they are, on sea they unfortunately not, and we also know that. But today we really want to focus, and there's a lot to say about shark finning, but today we really want to focus on shark finning in context with sustainable seafood, because that is something everybody, every consumer is really caring about. We want to try and do something right, buying sustainable seafood, thereby hoping that we do the right thing. But if this sustainable seafood is associated with finning or other crime, then obviously this is a problem, and that's something we need to stop. And in that aspect, we are talking about a report, and you are part of that report, and that's why we invited you to speak today here with us. We've published a report in February this year, which is called An Analysis of the Marine Stewardship Council's Policy on Shark Finning and the Opportunity for Adoption of a Fins Naturally Attached Policy in the MSC Fisheries Standard Review. So quite a long title. And I think the best way to talk about that report actually is looking or viewing together the video. But let me just, before we go into that, quickly introduce who's been involved in creating that report. And well, Alex is one of the authors, and here we still see him under Wild Aid. And he actually, yeah, I said, so I think you're living in the UK, you still do now. And Wild Aid was involved in that. Shark Project obviously was involved, but it's really a report that's been generated by experts across the globe, from Australia, from Costa Rica, from the US, and from Europe. And this report has been authored by experts from the individual NGOs across the world, as I just said. Together with Alex, it's been Leo Guida from Australia, Susan Milford from the US, Courtney Vail, also from the US, Katie Woodruff. And Katie is actually the voice of the video we're gonna hear shortly, and myself. So what is this report about? And this is what I'd like to do. And Alex, if you are open for an experiment, I would suggest that we have a look at that video together and then just view it together with the audience and discuss what the video is showing us, because I think it's the easiest way to really see what the problem is. Und für unsere Zuschauer, ich bitte um Entschuldigung, dass auch dieses Video jetzt auf Englisch ist. Ich hatte noch versucht, deutsche Untertitel reinzubekommen. Und prinzipiell gibt es diese Untertitel, nur sie sind nicht synchronisiert. Das hat irgendwie nicht geklappt. Also ich hoffe, es ist okay. Es ist sehr deutlich gesprochen und es ist auch mit Untertiteln, sodass es hoffentlich okay ist. Aber bitte Fragen stellen. Das ist im Übrigen etwas, was ich noch vergessen habe zu sagen. Jederzeit, wenn Fragen sind über die F&A-Funktion, können Fragen eingegeben werden. Und wir haben eine Kollegin, die im Hintergrund diese Fragen beobachtet und dafür sorgt, dass der Alex oder ich sie auch beantworten. Ja, shall we start the video?
Ja.
Okay, let me try whether I can do it this time. Because as I learned, it's not working when I try to do it this way from the presentation. I need to go and stop this. And then I have to go directly into YouTube and start it via YouTube. Okay, so hopefully.
The ocean is suffering. Overfishing, climate change and pollution are rapidly overwhelming marine species and habitats. And some species are more vulnerable than others. As the ocean's top predator, sharks hold the entire ecosystem in balance. However, their slow growth and low reproductive rates make their populations particularly vulnerable to decline as a result of overfishing. It is now estimated that up to 30% could be extinct within just decades. One of the key driving forces behind unsustainably high shark catch is shark finning. This is a cruel and wasteful practice where the shark's fins are cut off, often while the animal is still alive, and the rest of the body discarded at sea. Despite its cruelty, the shark fin trade is highly lucrative, with fins selling for huge amounts of money. While the financial reward remains so high, there is little incentive for fishers to stop targeting sharks for their fins or finning sharks which are accidentally hauled on board as bycatch. Banning shark finning alone cannot solve this.
You're on mute.
I'm just trying to avoid. Let's stop the video here a bit and let's talk about why would fisheries cut off the fins of an animal while it's still alive rather than taking the whole animal? So what is the reason, Alex?
Why? Well, so the reason is that the fins are the most lucrative part of the shark. The shark fins, they trade for a vastly much higher price than the meat does, which is often seen as low value, and it's actually quite easy to store on board a boat because they're quite small and they can be packed down, and especially if they're dried on the deck of the ship, they can be the weight can be reduced and they can be packed down further, so they become very lucrative. So that they can be sold in Asia for you know, hundreds of dollars per kilo of fins. So obviously it's been an incentive for many years for fishermen who are out hunting tuna to when they catch sharks to keep the shark fins. And so, and in some fisheries they're even going after sharks when they're ostensibly trying to be targeting another species, mm-hmm. such as swordfish. So it's all about
optimizing efficiency.
Well, it's about profit. That ultimately, that's the end of, you know, it's about money. Yeah. So it's a lucrative, the shark fin trade is a lucrative trade. So it attracts criminals as well. There's, you know, the criminal element of the shark fin trade has been well documented. Is this linked in with the abalone trade, which is linked to the drugs trade, human trafficking, arms trafficking, all of these. Illegal wildlife trade is the fourth largest transnational organized crime in the world, and the shark fin trade is part of that, and it should be recognized as such.
So it's illegal, but it's flourishing, and it's almost like the drug trade. And actually I heard that the profits are even bigger than in the trade or in the drug trafficking of heroin or stuff like that.
Well, it's like, if you look at it more broadly, it's the same with elephants hunting. You take a small part of the animal, which is the ivory tusk, or they hunt rhinos and just take a small part of the animal, which is the rhino horn. And these things end up being sold in illegal wildlife markets in Chinese places.
Horrible. Just let me ask quickly, gibt es Fragen? Hat jemand direkt für dieses Thema eine Frage? Nein, ich sehe nichts im Fragen. Gut, dann würden wir weitergehen. Und Alex, shall we go on and have a look like...
By all means.
There's just one question coming in now.
Thank you. Yes, please.
It's not a question. Okay. Seafood is a no-go. Start to be vegetarian.
Well, Steve is asking that. I have sympathy for that. I'm a vegetarian myself. Alex, are you a vegetarian?
I'm a flexitarian. I don't eat a lot of meat. I don't eat any red meat, but I don't eat a lot. Yeah, and I don't really eat much fish either. So I do eat a lot of tofu and those things. My wife's Chinese and she cooks tofu all the time.
Okay, so flexitarian. That's a nice definition. I mean, this is a completely different discussion we should have at the end of the webinar, I think, because it's an interesting point you make there, Steve, but it needs to be seen in a little bit of a broader context. But what I'd like to do is carry on with the video at this point, and let's have a look what is needed to ensure finning cannot happen, and what is currently available regulations and how good they are or not are. So lasst uns einfach mal schauen, was es für Möglichkeiten gibt, Finning zu verhindern und wie gut oder nicht gut sie funktionieren. Und jetzt versuche ich einfach, dieses Video wieder fortzusetzen. Okay, das funktioniert schon mal nicht. Bildschirm freigeben. Das ist jetzt gerade nicht gut. Entschuldigung, was ist jetzt passiert? Irgendwie hat er mich rausgeschmissen. Ich wusste, dass das etwas zu viel ist, was ich hier gerade versuche mit diesem... Nee, es kann er auch nicht mal die Adresse öffnen. Was ist denn jetzt los? Das macht er gar nichts mehr. Sorry, I'm not sure what's happening right now.
The ocean is suffering. Overfishing.
Yeah, he's back here. I can go. Okay. Okay.
Banning shark. Can you hear it? Alone cannot solve this crisis.
You hear it, but can't see it.
Can't see it. Okay.
Many, though far from all, okay. Though far from all countries and international.
Apologies, I don't know what I'm doing, so it's not. Why is it not doing this?
Nations already have bans on shark finning. However, these have not always been implemented effectively. Some bans still rely on a ratio-based approach, where fins can be removed at sea as long as the total weight of fins landed matches a predetermined percentage of the weight of bodies landed. Others allow cutting.
Why can't I show it anymore? I'm so sorry, this is ridiculous. Okay. I'm on YouTube. Maybe I just need to...
So Steve sagt, dass er sehen kann. Das gilt es für die anderen Teilnehmer auch?
Okay. Sollte jetzt wieder sichtbar sein, hoffe ich.
Jetzt passt's.
Okay, gut, dann probieren wir es wieder.
Many, though far from all countries and international organizations, already have bans on shark finning. However, these have not always been implemented effectively. Some bans still rely on a ratio-based approach, where fins can be removed at sea as long as the total weight of fins landed matches a predetermined percentage of the weight of bodies landed. Others allow cutting of fins at sea, but require fins to be artificially reattached to the bodies afterwards. Both of these approaches have many drawbacks. Ratio-based approaches contain a lot of ambiguity, as the ratios differ hugely between species and depending on the finning method used. Artificially reattaching fins create additional plastic waste, and it is not practical in fisheries where lots of sharks are caught because of the time and effort involved and the extensive monitoring needed to verify that the fins are attached to the right shark. Both methods are difficult to monitor and open up a major loophole. By allowing loose fins to be present on board, they make it very difficult to detect and prosecute incidences of illegal finning. While shark fin remains such a valuable commodity, the incentive to exploit any loophole which exists will be very high. This is why the only truly effective way of eliminating shark finning is to require all sharks to be landed with fins naturally attached, an approach which closes key loopholes. Fins naturally attached means that the fishers are not allowed to possess, transport, or land any shark that does not have all of its fins naturally attached to its body. If separated fins are spotted at any point, a breach has undeniably occurred and action can be taken. There is now a huge amount of scientific and practical evidence that fins naturally attached is the only genuinely effective approach. A growing number of countries around the world now require their fishing fleets to land all sharks with fins naturally attached. So.
Ja, wir stoppen hier nochmal ganz kurz, weil das ist jetzt doch eine Situation, die ich nochmal gerne mit Alex besprechen würde. Ich mache es jetzt so, ich gehe nicht mehr raus aus diesem Modus, sondern bleib hier in dem Modus, nicht, dass wir gleich nochmal das Problem haben. Alex, so you're going to be a bit small for the audience, unfortunately. I'm sorry about that, but I don't want to stop the sharing of the video. Don't want to end up in the next.
Go ahead. That's okay.
Yeah. But before we go on, and you already see the question has been raised, so what about the Marine Stewardship Council, the MSC, or as we say in Germany, the blue label, the blue tick for sustainable seafood? But in the previous section of the movie, we were hearing about three different ways to control or to ensure that finning cannot happen. And the fin to carcass ratio is definitely the most widely used and also traditionally widely used. Can you just tell the audience again why this doesn't work?
What doesn't work?
Why does a fins to carcass ratio? So if I allow a vessel to have fins on board, loose fins, and just say, oh, and you have to have so many bodies to match the fins, why will that never work?
Oh, because they can just fiddle the numbers. You know, things get washed around on the boats, and they might be transshipping the bodies or the fins from one vessel to another, and all kinds of tricks happen with the, you know, the logbooks and all that. So it's kind of, it's too complicated, and there's too many loopholes. It's too easy to, there's too much fraud that can happen, essentially.
And this is what the movie tried to explain. So as long as we have loose fins, you know, you will never be able to enforce that test happened. There's always an excuse you can have. Oh, I just, by the way, we miscalculated, or the shark has just gone overboard, or it's under deck, we can't find it right now. And you will always be able to distort the numbers.
Yeah. The fins naturally attached policy is quite a genius way of getting around the problem without implementing finning bans, because actually all you're doing is you're just forcing the fishing boats to actually bring, if they're going to do it, they have to bring the whole body. And if they do that, then of course these longline fishing boats, which is the type of boat that the tuna industry use, they're not that big. And if their freezers are actually quite small. And so if they were to do fins naturally attached, their freezers will get full very quickly, and they'd have to go back to port or transship. And so that's why they really don't like it, because it just, it, you know, uses too much of their freezer capacity.
Yeah. And actually, this is why the European Union has introduced fins naturally attached. Mm. And actually, first of all, they said, well, fins naturally attached, or they can keep the fin to carcass ratio if they can document it really matches. But then 10 years later, in 2013, the European Union came up with a resume, because they had reviewed all the reports that had been submitted, or rather not submitted. And the fact is, it didn't match. And then they said, well, okay, full stop. The only way we can have this under control is fins naturally attached without exemptions. But let's see what the MSC thinks about it. And there's just one question coming up. What is the question? Christina, can you read the question? I can't see it when I'm in the sharing mode.
Yeah, it's not really a question, it's like a statement.
Okay, right, let's hear the statement.
Yeah, Steve said, if I was the president, I probably would start a war because of this item.
Okay, well, unfortunately, none of us is the president. And starting a war is unfortunately also not the solution, but we need solutions. And this is why we are looking to the marine stewardship, because really sustainable, trustworthy, credible, sustainable seafood could be a solution. But let's hear what...
Just a second, there's another question coming in. Wie viel Prozent reduziert fins naturally attached die Fangquote?
That's a good question. Alex, I'm not sure whether you want to take that. I'm just reading it to you. So does fins naturally attach per se by any percentage reduce the catch quantity or not?
Sorry, I can't hear you. What do you say?
Oh, sorry. Does fins naturally attached reduce the number of sharks that are caught, actually, or doesn't it?
I think it would, yeah. I think it would, because it forces the fishing boats to land the whole shark. Rather, of course, that's not a good thing, but they would have to do that, and therefore that slows the whole process down. If they can just catch the shark, fin it, and then throw the body overboard and just retain just a small amount of fins from one shark, they can catch way more sharks, including the endangered species, at which a third of all the sharks are threatened by extinction. So
I'm going to come to that in a moment, but yes, absolutely. And this is the point. Obviously, it's not reducing their intent to catch the sharks, but it's in reducing their capacity to do so. Because as Alex explained, the freezer capacity on board of these longliners is not so big. So if they have to keep the whole animal, this is going to limit the number of sharks they can have per trip or per vessel. Obviously, this alone is not going to solve the whole problem. We need better regulations in general, and we also need other additional measures, but it definitely has an impact. But let's hear now what the MSC is doing, or not, rather not doing.
What about the Marine Stewardship Council, or MSC, the blue tick eco label? MSC is one of the world's leading sustainable seafood certification schemes. The organisation banned shark finning in 2012 and repeatedly states that it has zero tolerance for it. So, can we assume that there is no shark finning happening in MSC certified fisheries and that MSC requires the most rigorous approach, a fins naturally attached policy, to be in place across all fisheries? No. In fact, the MSC lags far behind the curve of global fisheries management. It still does not require fisheries to have a fins naturally attached policy in place in order to gain or maintain certified status. So, can MSC really claim to have zero tolerance? Not exactly. Shark finning still occurs in all parts of the world more often than we would like to believe, including in MSC certified fisheries. The oceans are paying the price for this. More than half of all oceanic sharks are now endangered, and the number of sharks has declined by more than 70% since 1970. For many years now, stakeholders have spoken out about the ineffectiveness of the MSC's current approach on shark finning, which largely leaves it to the discretion of the certifying agent to decide whether they believe finning happens in a fishery or not. And the occurrence of incidences of shark finning in certified fisheries speaks for itself in demonstrating that current requirements are not adequate or effective. Nevertheless, MSC has so far refused to require fins naturally attached as a prerequisite for certification. Instead, it has been influenced by financial arguments used by the fishing industry to claim that fins naturally attached is not practical or feasible, despite the fact that it has already been effectively implemented by many large fishing nations. Conservationists and consumers alike are understandably confused as to why MSC is protecting a status quo, which is helping to further deplete endangered sharks with catastrophic impacts on marine ecosystems, the full extent of which we still don't fully understand. This year, however,
let's do another quick break and just give the audience the opportunity if they have any direct questions to that part of the video.
Keine Fragen, Chat.
Keine Fragen, okay. Wenn das nicht der Fall ist, dann versuche ich nochmal eine Frage an uns alle zu stellen. So Alex, let me ask a question to all of us. If we all agree that fins naturally attached is the only way to actively prevent shark finning to happen, and the MSC has a zero tolerance policy, why can it then not introduce fins naturally attached, as has been requested by so many stakeholders so far? And I mean, this is a bit speculative, I have to admit, but what do you think really is the background, or why would MSC not listen to those stakeholders asking for that?
Well, I think the problem is that the MSC, due to its structure, due to its business model, is largely beholden to commercial interests and has more like a window dressing stakeholder consultation process, where it says that it consults NGOs, but it doesn't really listen to NGOs. It more like it listens to the fishing industry. So if the fishing industry really push back hard on a thing such as fins naturally attached, then the MSC will just roll over like a kitten and just, say, okay, no problem.
Kitten, okay.
So they don't really take into account the strong feeling of the NGOs and also the global public that just want to be shot of this problem of shark finning. They will say that, you know, they don't tolerate shark finning at all in MSC certified fisheries. And yet they are way behind, like it says in the video, way behind on the curve of of implementing fins naturally attached. The way that the different regional fisheries management organizations around the world, you know, that's the body that takes care of fishing in the Pacific or the Indian Ocean or the Atlantic, have all done that. And so many countries across the world, you know, in Europe, in Asia, in Africa, all over the world are doing this. But somehow the MSC, which is supposed to be at the vanguard, at the tip of the spear for marine sustainability, they're right at the back and then haven't not even doing it, because the fishing industry, I think New Zealand is the case in point, and I think you know more about that.
Let me talk about that.
The fishing industry are the ones that are pushing back, and the MSC just says, okay.
Okay, there is questions I just seen. Before we see the last bit of the video, I'd like to, Christina, are there any questions we are should take right now?
Steve schreibt nochmal, USA sprengt Millionen Tiere in das Meer wegen einer Flugzeugträgers und hat uns auch nochmal einen Link dazu zu einem Beitrag geteilt.
Okay, aber
den Beitrag kenne ich jetzt auch selber noch nicht, aber ich werde mir den auch nachher mal anschauen.
Okay, gut, aber das
eine Frage. Ja?
Das hat jetzt aber gerade nicht mit
ein moderner Flugzeugträger im Ernstfall aus. Dieser
Was das?
Okay. I just clicked on that link.
Oh, okay, sorry. Okay, Alex, no, please. What you're confusing me completely. Okay, but we keep that to the end. Is there another question for Alex at this point or for me?
Ja, eine Frage kam noch. Das Thema Greenwashing wird ja immer präsenter in den Medien. Gibt es die Möglichkeit, hier noch mehr Druck auf MSC aufzubauen?
Das ist eine sehr gute Frage und genau das ist es, wo wir dann gleich, wenn der letzte Teil des Videos fertig ist, auch drüber sprechen sollten. Wie können wir noch mehr Druck auf das MSC aufbauen? Weil das MSC versucht sich gerade, und Alex hat es ja gerade beantwortet, es richtet sich nach den Interessen der Fischerei. Aber letztendlich sollte es sich nach den Interessen der Verbraucher richten. Und das ist wirklich die Gretchenfrage. Wie kann man diesen Druck aufbauen? Und da können wir gleich am Schluss noch mal drüber ein paar Ideen. Also da ist auch Alex an einer anderen Kampagne dran, um eben genau das zu erreichen. Gerade einmal zurückstellen und dann würde ich den Rest des Videos zeigen, außer da ist noch was Dringendes, was jetzt zu diesem Thema gehört. Also letztendlich, warum wird Fins Naturally Attached nicht eingeführt bisher? Gut, dann gehen wir erstmal weiter, ist auch gleich zu Ende des Videos und dann können wir nochmal alles diskutieren.
The MSC is reviewing its standard and has an opportunity to listen to the calls for action and introduce a Fins Naturally Attached policy as a prerequisite for certification with no exemptions. Like any policy, this will need to be supported by strong monitoring and enforcement activity at a level appropriate to the fishery. The time for action is now, and the urgency is such that MSC must look to tried and tested solutions. Fins Naturally Attached is already required by 44% of the world's major shark fishing nations. This should not be an unrealistically challenging level for a supposedly gold standard eco-label to attain. Instead of trailing behind global sustainability trends, MSC should be leading them. By requiring fins naturally attached with no exemptions, it would not only provide greater protection to sharks across its 400 certified fisheries, but also send a powerful signal to the rest of the industry. Given the rate of decline in shark numbers, this may be the last chance for MSC to make a real difference. Join us in calling for a fin-free MSC now.
Yes, fin-free MSC now, that's what we are calling for. And at this point, I also would like to thank all of the people who helped making this video, not just the authors of the report, but also Magnus Larsen, who did that video for us, and all the people who contributed footage for it and pictures. and of course, all of the people who helped make it happen on a pro bono basis, basically, because what we want to do is we want to force the MSC to listen to us. And this was exactly what one of the audience just asked, like, how can we increase the pressure on them? So let me go back to Alex here. And Alex, we talked about why MSC is not listening, and you mentioned the New Zealand fishery. There was an interview, a webinar today from the MSC. Funnily enough, it was called a debate, but only participants from MSC participating. And there was also the question, like, why would a fishery insist of not introducing fins naturally attached, when we just heard 44% of all of the fishing nations already have it? Why would a fishery, an MSC certified fishery, by the way, refuse or argue not to have fins naturally attached? Can you maybe just share with us what they said during that webinar?
Yeah, that was just one new thing that I heard them say, which was I'd never heard before, which is they said that if they were forced to bring the entire body of the shark on board the ship, that that it would cause a smell, and then the smell of those sharks would permeate into the other catch of the other species of fish that they were going to sell. So it would ruin the other catch, maybe the targeted catch of the other species of fish. I'm not sure which one they're talking about, because there's a high urea content in sharks, because sharks, as you may know, don't actually have a bladder. They excrete their urine just through their body, and so that's why you smell the stink of ammonia in places where they sell shark fin, or in shark fin markets in Hong Kong. It's an ammonia smell, and you get that smell on the boat. So they're probably worried about the ammonia of the shark going into the other fish, which I've never heard before.
Yeah, which is ridiculous in a way, because, and this is really interesting, and I haven't been joining this debate today, but it's really interesting they say that, because actually those fisheries, they keep the sharks, because they are, besides the other species, which is hoki, they are targeting, they are also selling the sharks. And in New Zealand, sharks are part of a quota, so they are quota species. And there is an exemption from fins naturally attached for these quota species. And the argument they bring, why they don't need fins naturally attached, because the meat of the sharks is worth more than the fins. So there would be no incentive to do finning and to dump the shark body when they can make so much more money from the meat. So the argument they are using officially is a different one than from what obviously has been discussed in this webinar today, which is also quite strange to say.
Well, you know, in the business world, the people are cutting deals all the time, right, left and center. So if MSC are placing themselves right in the middle of all that, of course they have to cut deals and do funny stuff in the background. So that's why.
This is why, yes. But, and I promised that to our audience, we are not giving up. The reason why we published this report is to offer MSC a neutral source with arguments. And we've actually mentioned all of these arguments. We've got all of the arguments and counter arguments in that report. And the final conclusion really is that there is enough evidence from finning still happening in MSC certified fisheries. So it's not something we are making up. But if there is any evidence of finning, according to the MSC, this should obviously make a fishery ineligible. So it could be not certified. That cannot be. And any fishery interacting with sharks in any way, therefore, must have a fins naturally attached. You know, it's one thing monitoring and policing what happens, which is actually really bad to do on sea, because nobody's out there to watch and to document, or having at least the strongest enforceable policy in place that if you find something, you really can prosecute them. Because so far, there's no way to prosecute finning because you never really can approve it. So that's why we are requesting the MSC to introduce a fins naturally attached for all fisheries that interact with sharks and for all of their species. So the ones they want to catch, the ones that are bycatch, and the ones that are specially protected ETP species, there it should be a no-go anyways. And in order to ensure that this is done correctly, of course, we need surveillance and monitoring. We need to verify that compliance happens. And this again is something, I mean, if you have a small Poland line fishery that catches a few tons, the risk is not as high as if you have a big long line fleet with hundreds of vessels. And if they go out and do finning, that's a much higher risk. If you have a fishery that fishes in fresh water in a lake, there's no risk they are going to interfere with sharks and do finning. So this needs to be a risk-based approach. And that's what we are requesting from a group that is now called FinFreeMSC, asking them to introduce as part of their standard review at SG60, which is the prerequisite for certification. So if a fishery doesn't meet this SG60, it can't be certified. So if there's fins naturally attached at that level, then we would really have the strongest possible enforcement in place. And this is what this group is really asking, because the MSC hinkt weit hinterher. Alex hat es gerade schon gesagt. Die Welt geht vorwärts. Und das heißt nicht unbedingt immer, dass sie das tut, was sie tun sollte, aber es ist Bewegung drin. Nur das MSC, das hält an alten Ritualen fest, nur weil es eben unbequem ist für manche Fischereien. Nicht unmöglich, sondern nur unbequem. Oder vielleicht etwas weniger Profit bringt. Und das ist das Tolle daran, dass ganz viele sich uns anschließen. Alex, have you had a look at recently, like who are all the supporters of FinFreeMSC? It's
You have it on the screen there.
Yeah, it's a growing number. And what's really good to see, and this is important, and coming back to the question we had before, it's not just NGOs anymore. We have Marks and Spencers, we have Migros, die Schweizer Migro, die sagt ganz klar, nee, das geht überhaupt nicht. Ihr müsst Fins naturally attached als Mindestvoraussetzung einführen. And the same does Marks and Spencer. Marks and Spencer supports Fins naturally attached at SG60. And by the way, it's not just those who are openly putting their label here. There's also a lot of retailers that are associated in a group where they won't let us put their logo on, but they've told us that they have written the same request to the MSC, fins naturally attached without exemptions at SG60. So there is growing support for this request. Unfortunately, MSC is still not listening. And this is where we really should think about how can we increase the pressure. And the pressure is only going to be increased when we bring more stakeholders, powerful stakeholders in that are requesting it. So more retailers, maybe politicians, maybe at the parliament requesting it, the supply chain, because obviously NGOs is something MSC is not listening. And before I ask this question, and I have a specific question in mind for Alex in that aspect, I would just want to inform you about the latest consultation. And again, this is something, didn't they say today in the webinar also, they really value stakeholder input and there's consultations where there is a transparent process, how they are changing their standard and they are involving, and they had so many people joining in that. I think that's what they said, right, Alex?
I'm sorry?
In that webinar, didn't they proclaim they have such a transparent process?
Yeah, they said that, you know, they've got the different committees and the stack and the tab, and everybody's independent of each other. But as we all know, that these people kind of all know each other, and it's all nod, nod, wink, wink. And, you know, things happen differently behind the scenes to the public facing way. So I don't think that they are as independent as they pretend, as they say they are. And that's why other NGOs and are calling for an independent third party reform of the MSC, to have an outsider come in and shake up the organization and perhaps fire a lot of stuff and you know, change of leadership and get the thing operating properly the way it's supposed to be, like perhaps the FSC, the Forest Stewardship Council, which, although it's not perfect, it has a much better governance structure. You know, you have the they have different stakeholders. They've got the business sector, the NGO sector, and communities, and each has a third responsibility, whereas in the MSC it's like 80% of it or more is represented by fishing industry. And, you know, some people within the FinFreeMSC have tried to get onto the board, get onto the scientific committee and everything, but every time the door is closed, and they won't accept any outsiders to come in and really be a part of the process. It's always through these long-winded kind of webinars that happen every year, and then a
nothing
survey, and nothing changes. It's just it's all window dressing, like I said in the beginning. It's just, you know, it's pretty much hot air. But to the public, it looks like they are you know, valuing their stakeholders, but really it's not. It's just it's puff.
And I mean, this is a very good statement you're just, or comment you're making, because we just told you what we tried to convince them. There's a report with 40 pages. There has been workshops with stakeholders clearly commenting that they expect fins naturally attached to be introduced without exemptions. There have been surveys where people have raised that. And what do they do? In June, they published a new survey where they provided only one option to be consulted upon. So they didn't give us a choice. They didn't say, like, do you want fins naturally attached without exemptions? What they did is, and this is coming back to this New Zealand fishery, they propose now they will introduce fins naturally attached at SG60, so as we request, as a minimum requirement, but they are not doing it, they are giving an exemption. So the Ausnahme ist dann, wenn die Fischerei gezielt Haie jagt. So wenn Haie eine der Art sind, entweder diese zertifiziert haben wollen oder zumindest eine Art, die sie offiziell als Target haben, dann müssen sie kein Fins naturally attached haben. So those fisheries that have most sharks on board because they are targeting, they are exempt from fins naturally attached. And the explanation is because they are so well controlled, they are so closely monitored, and they are enforcing a no finning policy. And they are so trustworthy that they don't need to do that. And this really shows, as you say, they are not listening to stakeholders.
Mm. So they pretend to listen to stakeholders.
They pretend, this is it. They pretend, but they are not listening. And this is where we really need to think about how can we increase the pressure on them further. And you just mentioned that call for an independent review. So who is
third party?
Pardon?
A third party has to come in from the outside, neutral party. Yeah, I mean, to be clear, we're not calling for the MSC to be disbanded. The MSC has a very, very important role to play. It's just not fit for purpose right now. That's the problem. You know, of course they have to be there, because if they were not there, it would be awful. There'd be, the fisheries would just go out and hunt everything to extinction, and it would all be, definitely all be gone. So they need to be there, but they just need to up their game. They just need to improve themselves and reduce their dependency on the blue tick licensing. That's the problem, because it's so lucrative, and that, so there's a conflict for them to always keep certifying any old fishery, even if it's you know, not sustainable at all. They would just do it anyway.
And I mean, one good example is There has not been a single fishery that didn't get certified. Like every fishery that goes into the certification process gets certified. There's only one example now, and that's a very recent one that happened actually last summer, that an Australian fishery that wanted to certify a fishery, a species that is actually a protected species in Australia, orange roughy, which is not a shark, but it's also a very low reproductive species. Granatbarsch heißt der auf Deutsch. Und der wird 150 Jahre alt und ist in Australien geschützt. Und den wollten sie zertifizieren, eine Fischerei, die den fängt. Und das ist nach hinten losgegangen. But that's the only example that ever that a fishery did not get certified when they wanted to. The only other example in the past was Echebasta in the Indian Ocean, but they just had to do it twice. They got rejected the first time because they had made a procedural mistake that they included the yellowfin for certification. And in the next attempt, they just didn't include the yellowfin, so they got certified. Mm. So there's almost, I'm saying usually, there's almost no way to avoid certification once you've applied for it, other than if you go, yeah, if you die, then you are not getting certified, but otherwise than that. But yes, Alex, thanks so much for doing that little experiment with me, going through the movie and discussing the MSC. And as you mentioned, there is a call for third party review, and maybe this is really what it needs. Because what will happen now is they've done the consultation, and we are going to, from FinFreeMSC, we are going to publish the results before MSC does it, because MSC will take 5 months. But then they will come up next year with a proposal how they will change their standard. And if this proposal now is what they want to do, then for finning, this is the end. There won't be a possibility to stop and improve finning in MSC certified fisheries if they go through with this proposal right now. Are there any other questions from the audience that we haven't answered yet? Roswitha, Roswitha, I hope we answered your question mit dem Greenwashing. Das mit dem Druck, das ist genau das, was wir versucht haben zu erklären. Der Druck kann nur von dort aufgebaut werden, wo das Geld fließt. Das heißt, die Händler, die Supply Chain oder independent von Regierungen, von Governments, die sagen, ihr müsst hier wirklich mehr NGO mit einbeziehen. Von uns kann sich das aufgebaut. Yes.
Just wanted to add one more thing that, you know, the problem is also that the MSC always talk about the product. You see, talk about the product. Whereas from my perspective, we're talking about nature, we're talking about biodiversity, we're talking about the way that the planet functions as a living organism. If you take all the sharks out of the ocean, or you chop down all the trees in the Amazon, everything goes crazy. We've been seeing that with climate change. You know, there's a lot of problems that are happening around the world now. And it's good to see that the UN CBD, the Convention on Biodiversity in Kunming at the end of the year, that they want to really tackle the extinction problem. But I never hear the MSC ever talking about the fisheries in this way, about how this is actually nature, that the fishing industry is going out there and hunting these species, that are, and once they're gone, they're gone, they're gone forever, and it's going to knock the nature out of sync. And it's not just a product, you know, this is, it's hard for me to put into words, but it's from my heart, is this is nature we're talking about, not a product. It's not just about money.
It shouldn't be, but for MSC, unfortunately, it seems to be. And there is one, it's not really a question, it's more a statement I see here from Claudia. Naja, MSC sollte sich nach dem Interesse der Fische richten, so verstehe ich zumindest Nachhaltigkeit. Da ist eine kleine Gefahr drin. Und wenn man auf MSC hört, dann tun sie das sogar. aber nur die Fische, die sie zertifizieren. Talking about this question, you know, it's the fish they are looking for, to. And this is really what they do. They just focus on, is this stock in this area where they are certifying it? Is this stock okay? And if the stock is halfway okay, then they are certifying it. But they are not looking, as you just said, to the whole ecosystem, to all the other affected species. The habitat, if the habitat is destructed by bottom trawling, if there's a lot of
bite. The fads problem in the shark fisheries, per se in fisheries, the sharks getting caught up in those horrible fads that are just, you know, being abandoned or drifting for thousands of miles across different jurisdictions, including marine protected areas that everybody is so keen on today. And these are like a wrecking machines, just killing all the endangered species, not just sharks and turtles and, you know, juvenile tuna, all kinds of stuff.
Yeah. And then in the end, those fads, at one point they beach and they destroy coral reefs when beaching.
With the plastics.
Well, not just the plastic, but the solid material. And the plastic, of course, then the plastic is in the ocean. Yeah. It's all of those impacts which MSC does unfortunately not really consider.
Because they don't focus on the fisheries type. They say today they said there's only two fisheries gear types that they don't certify, and that is poison and explosive, because those are from the FAO. They follow the FAO to the letter. Exactly. So that's the problem, you see, because the FAO in itself has a big problem. That is only industry and you know, scientists on there with not much NGO representation. So you go back and back and you see where the domino effect of problems begins.
But there's a really interesting question I just see here from Volker. And I think, Alex, this is going to be a fun question for you. How is the MSC financed? Does the MSC just sell a certificate for fishing companies, or do they get money for it?
No, they get money from the blue tick, you know, the eco label. So when you go to the supermarket and then you buy fish fingers or salmon or any of those, you go to the seafood section and it's got the little blue tick on it. That's what they get the money from. They 80% of their revenue from licensing that blue tick, so that the seafood companies can put that on their product, so that the consumer thinks, oh, that's great, you know, I'd rather buy that, which has got the MSC logo, than the other stuff, which doesn't. So, you know, there is a place for those certification schemes. They're a great thing, but they have to be run and managed properly and not just be done in a sort of rampantly capitalistic way. And the other remaining 20% comes from donations from large philanthropic foundations like the Bill and Lucille Packard Foundation, and I think Walton Foundation as well. So, you know, we've written to them to ask them to, you know, have a look at MSC, and you need to follow the money. In any whenever there's a problem, you just need to follow the money, and then that's, you see what's really happening behind the scenes.
And there's actually a really funny statement they also made today. They are an NGO.
They are under the UK. They're actually under the UK Charities Commission. They are. Technically, they are.
It sounds like a joke, doesn't it? But yes, they are. And unfortunately, this is also one of the problems, that they are an NGO on the one side and a business on the other side. And combining an NGO with a business is always a very difficult situation. And we see that in the case of MSC, it's not really working.
But we just want to reiterate, we're not trying to disband them. We're not shooting at them to, you know, to get rid of them. We want them just to improve and to actually do what they're supposed to be doing, which is providing a real proper stewardship for the marine area.
Yeah, and that's what we need. And I see one question from Roswitha again, where she is saying, so the only thing that stays is we need better education and we need to boycott buying this fish or buying fish at all. And Roswitha, I would really want to amplify what Alex has just said. It's not the solution. The solution is not having no certification. The solution is also not buying no fish anymore, because actually there are some really good fisheries. There are fisheries in the MSC certification system that made a lot of improvements. But those fisheries, they get the same label, and those are mostly Poland line, or there used to be a handheld harpoon swordfish fishery. So those are the ones that are most sustainable because they catch one fish at a time. And they should get the label, but they are in the same bucket as the big fishery that catches 1.5 million tuna, 5 million tons tuna per year, and kills 100 thousands of sharks every year, and does finning and doesn't have to do fins naturally attached. So it's not the solution to say nothing, but we need a credible label. And maybe one point, and I keep saying that, so bear with me, those of you who've heard me before, if the consumer goes in and really increases the pressure on the retailer, then more retailers will increase the pressure and on MSC. And Alex just said, follow the money, because the retailers actually pay the license fees. So if the retailers, all of them stand up and say, well, this enough is enough, then this is probably not maybe the same as if the fishery, but it's definitely matching and much more powerful than if we as NGOs just say that. So as a consumer, you have the power and you should try and use that also.
Yeah, so the consumers, they can email or write to the retailers, you know, the customer service at tesco.com, for example, or whatever.
Yeah. And this is what Claudia is just proposing here, a boycott. Well, a boycott is they don't hear from you. But if you write to them and say, well, I'm not accepting that, you have to change that. And if every day they get 100 letters, or have even customers in the shop saying, I'm not buying this because you need to ensure this is really sustainable, that is really making. So boycotting, but boycotting it with a loud voice and not just silently boycotting, this would be really helpful.
Hmm. Well, it's like the main brands of tuna, like John West or Prince's, that come under Thai Union. These are the problematic brands that are being sold out in Tesco. These are the ones that are using fad fisheries. These are the ones that are being certified by MSC. So, you know, it doesn't matter what these companies like Thai Union say, they, you know, all this sustainability, blah, blah. At the end, some NGOs partnering with them because they can't resist them anymore. At the end of the day, they're still doing bad stuff and the sharks are getting slaughtered in those per se nets. But you know, that's the best way, is just to don't buy John West tuna, don't buy Prince's brand tuna, and make the supermarket chains aware of that.
Well,
do you actually have them in Germany, those brands?
No, this is what I was just going to say. That doesn't help the German audience. John West, I'm not 100% sure, but we don't have Princess, for example, but we have one brand, and that's something you can actually find in the shops. It's called Pacifical. If you look on the tuna tin and it says Pacifical, that is from that tuna fishery in the Western Central Pacific that we know that shark finning occurs, and where they refuse to introduce fins naturally attached, and where they refuse to have a transparency, and they are using fats and all of these things. So this is one of the fisheries we've been calling out a lot of times. And
which supermarket is it being sold in Germany?
It's in several supermarkets. It's in Rewe, it's in Edeka and in Penny. So, but it's the brand really, Pacifical.
Hmm.
And it's really clearly visible because it's on the tin. It has an image on the tin saying Pacifical.
So you're advising German consumers not to buy this product. Are you, Iris?
Well, we are advising consumers when they buy MSC certified products at the moment only to go for pole and line. This is the only one we are recommending, because all of the others, we know there's problems because the standard is not strong enough. So pole and line MSC certified is fine. You don't get harpooned swordfish in Germany, but well, it exists, but not in Germany. By the way, if you buy swordfish in Germany, I would be super careful because that could also be mako yeah. shark. But this is the only one we recommend at the moment. Mm. Are there any other questions? Because I'm aware we're already over the time, but definitely I want to make sure we answer all of the questions while we have Alex here. Gibt es denn eine Liste mit den E-Mail-Adressen? Da muss ich zurückfragen, welchen E-Mail-Adressen?
Which email?
Ja, that, I don't know.
Ich denke, Alex hat es vorhin angedeutet, dass man sich ja auch gerne per E-Mail melden kann. Ah. Ich denke, darauf bezieht sich die Frage von Roswitha.
Okay, dann sind es die Händler-E-Mail-Adressen. Die sind tatsächlich im Internet zu finden. Also von jedem deutschen Händler findet man die E-Mail-Adressen im Internet. Und da gibt es überall so eine Consumer-Feedback-Abteilung, wo man eben hinschreiben kann. Manchmal ist es eine E-Mail, manchmal oder oftmals ist es eigentlich ein Formular, wo man keine E-Mail, sondern man kann direkt auf der Webseite das Formular ausfüllen und aber Consumer-Feedback geben. Das hat jeder Händler. Ob das Penny ist, ob das Rewe ist, ob das Edeka ist. Und ich muss echt sagen, es ist sehr traurig, dass die deutschen Händler bisher nicht unterstützen. Die reagieren einfach nicht. Wir haben sie angeschrieben, wir haben versucht, sie aufzufordern, dass sie sich doch uns anschließen und eben das zumindest dieses FinFree fordern. Keine Reaktion. Da sind die Schweizer verantwortungsvoller, muss man ganz ehrlich sagen. Und auch zumindest einige der englischen Consumer. Any further questions we can answer? And I really appreciate, ich sage das jetzt auf Deutsch, es ist super toll, dass ihr all die Fragen und auch Kommentare in den Chat einstellt. Bitte versteht, dass wir natürlich auf solche Statements sozusagen nicht alle reagieren können, weil wir können nichts ändern, die Fische zu essen oder Thunfisch zu essen. Wir können nur informieren und wir können euch als Verbraucher auffordern, dass ihr eure Power nutzt, um eben eine Verbesserung herbeizuführen. Denn wie Alex gesagt hat, die Lösung ist nicht, MSC abzuschaffen, weil es gibt momentan kein besseres Label. Die Lösung muss sein, MSC muss die Verbesserungen machen, die es braucht, damit wir ihm wieder vertrauen können. Und dann würde sich wirklich was tun, weil wir brauchen eine Reform zu nachhaltigen Fisch. Und da vielleicht eine Information an alle. Die EU hat letztes Jahr eine offizielle Consultation gemacht. There's been an EU consultation for labeling of sustainable seafood. So what would consumers expect to be on a label? Und genau solche Dinge brauchen wir eigentlich. Da muss draufstehen, genau mit welchem Fanggerät es gefangen worden ist, wie viel Beifang dabei passiert. Nicht einfach nur zu sagen, MSC zertifiziert, sondern der Verbraucher muss die Transparenz haben und wissen, was ist da alles mit dabei. Und dann kann er auch entscheiden, kauft er das oder kauft er das nicht. Alex, I've started saying what I believe in as like a statement or a slogan to say together we are stronger. And I asked you when we started that interview, what would be your slogan? But maybe you can think of one just real quickly. Like, what is your mantra?
Well, you know, I've only started with Shark Guardians since a month ago, but I was working for Wild Aid for 7 years prior to that. And I was very attracted to the Wild Aid slogan, which was when the buying stops, the killing can too.
Okay, very interesting. But of course, that doesn't really fit to the MSC because we need them more to reform and use the stop the buying in order to force them to reform. That would be really helpful.
Well, when the buying of fad caught tuna stops, the killing of sharks can too.
Right, exactly. That is a good one. Thank you so much, Alex. And thanks for staying all that time and answering the questions and really bearing with us and sharing your insight. And I would also like to thank all of our audience for staying on, even staying on longer than initially planned. It's been a pleasure to discuss with you. And apologies again for the debacle with the video. That is my incompetence of trying to do three things at a time. Also, they always say women can do multitasking, but as you see, I couldn't. So apologies for that.
That's okay. Thank you for having me.
It's been my pleasure. Thanks a lot. And please, let's keep up the work and let's keep up the pressure on the MSC. Und an alle Teilnehmer aus Deutschland vor allem, aber auch insgesamt, wir haben ja auch international immer wieder Gäste, die uns beitreten. Wir haben noch weitere Webinare. Morgen ist das große zum Tag des Shark Awareness Days, wo es um Stop Finning, Stop the Trade geht, worüber wir heute gar nicht gesprochen haben, weil das ist natürlich nochmal ein ganz anderer Ansatzwinkel, den Handel zu unterbinden. Und auch da hat ja Alex schon gesagt, hat er sich in der Vergangenheit sehr stark engagiert. Wir haben noch Webinare zu einem Instrument oder einer Methode, um diese Hainetze und das Drumming von Haien, also das Töten von Haien an den Stränden zu verhindern. Wir haben noch andere Wissenschaftler mit in Webinaren, also die gehen bis zum Sonntag mit den unterschiedlichsten Themen, Shark Nurseries, Great White Mystery, was wir versuchen in Mexiko über die großen weißen Haie herauszufinden. Viele spannende Themen. Seid dabei, meldet euch an und ich hoffe, es hat euch Spaß gemacht und freue mich, wenn wir uns in einem der anderen Webinare wiedersehen, wo es dann andere Gastgeber sind, die hoffentlich etwas kompetenter mit der Technologie zurechtkommen. Alex, thank you so much. Thank you for being with us. Have a pleasant evening.
You too.
And schönen guten Abend an alle da draußen. Vielen Dank fürs Dabeisein und für die tollen Fragen.
Tschüss.
Bye bye. Tschüss.